Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Mike Swetnam, and I'm the CEO and chairman of the board of directors of the Potomac Institute for Policy Studies, and it's my distinct privilege and honor to welcome you today to a discussion about ISIS and whether it's an emerging global threat or a regional threat, or exactly what type of a threat it is. As most of you know, the Potomac Institute is a not-for-profit engaged in the issues of science and technology and how they affect our national security, and we're proud to say that for 20 years we've been engaging in these issues. I'd like to specifically thank Professor Don Wallace, who has partnered with us on this series of terrorism seminars for going on a decade. And thank you for your tireless support for our program and for the program that you run at the International Law Institute. I'd also like to thank our Board of Regents members who have joined us today and continue to support everything that we do. And a very special welcome to our Congressman Jim Moran, who has joined us today, who has been not just a great supporter of the Institute, but a tireless advocate of strong security here in the United States. Thank you, sir, for coming. The Potomac Institute's terrorism studies here have been ongoing for almost 16 years. Over those 16 years, we have covered almost every terror group in the United States, but our history goes back to the late 1990s when Professor Yonah Alexander co-hosted with us a series of seminars on terror groups that were emerging around the world. And we started writing books and pamphlets about those terror groups. Preeminent, of course, amongst the group of bad guys back in the 1990s was a little-known group called Al-Qaeda. Their leader, Osama bin Laden, had actually declared war on the United States. However, few people paid attention. Later, during that decade, he actually attacked some of our embassies and blew them up. And still, there wasn't a great deal of attention paid, although we held a number of seminars and wrote a few volumes on Al-Qaeda during that time frame. He again declared war on the United States a second time, and later on sponsored the attack on a U.S. warship. The comments that were bandied about in the late 90s, early 2000s were that he's a regional threat. He's not capable of striking the United States. And of course he did on 9/11. There's a big debate in and around this town and in fact the world about the level and the nature of the threat we call ISIS or ISIL, depending on whether you're crediting them with Iraq or the Levant. But that group, of course, has grown in power, probably is the richest, at the moment the largest version of Al-Qaeda we've seen since the word Al-Qaeda, the base, was invented by Osama bin Laden. Monday, we heard words from some of our leaders saying that ISIS is not a direct threat to the United States, that it's a regional threat. I would remind everybody of the 1990s. Of course it's a threat to the United States. The question is, how will we deal with it? How will we develop a strategy to prevent what happened in 9/11? And I'm proud that at the Potomac Institute, Professor Yonah Alexander has been engaged in the study of these issues, the development of policy options for dealing with organizations like ISIS for many, many decades. For those of you that aren't familiar with Yonah Alexander, and there's probably two people in the world who don't know about Professor Yonah Alexander, but for those of you who don't know, he's published over 100 books. His Center for the Study of Terrorism here is allied and affiliated with several dozen academic think tanks and organizations around the world, dozens of professors, and he publishes routinely on all of these issues. The most recent publication released today talks about security issues in Latin America. And before that, just a week before that, he dealt with the issues of the Palestine issue and the terror threats in and around that part of the world. It's a privilege to have Professor Alexander at the Potomac Institute. And as always, he's brought together a panel of some of the most thoughtful people, the most learned scholars on these issues. And I know that you will enjoy, and I hope gain and benefit from their thoughts on this growing insidious problem that we call ISIS or ISIL. So with that, I'd like to turn the agenda over to Professor Alexander, who will introduce our panel, and then we'll get on with it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mike, for the introduction. I would like to join him to welcome the panelists as well as the audience and those who collaborated with us over the years, the diplomatic community in Washington and internationally. As Mike indicated, we're going to focus with ISIS, and we have a very distinguished panel with rich background and experience. You have the bios, so I won't go into details to introduce them, but first we have Professor Ruth Wedgwood right here to my left, not politically, but at any rate, she's a professor of international law diplomacy, Johns Hopkins University, and the president of the International Law Association, and she served with government, State Department, and different administrations over the years. Next to her is Dr. Wayne Zaidman, a former legal attaché in the Middle East and agent in the United States, and he dealt with these issues both domestically and internationally, so we'll get a perspective from law enforcement. Next to him is Ambassador Ed Marks, next to Wayne, who served for many years at the State Department. He dealt with terrorism issues and he served all over the world. And then Don Raviv, who was very known to many of us for many years, CBS News. He was based in the Middle East and Europe. And I have a copy of his book, which we'll show later on. He published a number of books on intelligence. And then, of course, we have our colleague, Professor Don Wallace, the chairman of International Law Institute that Mike mentioned, that we collaborated for decades. And last but not least, a great American, General Al Gray, who will have the final word right here. So what I would like to do with your permission, number one, to remind all of us, including myself, that we should turn off this little gadget. We don't need any music now. And we want to thank C-SPAN for bringing the proceedings and the debate to a wider audience, because the civic society can and should play a role in the debate. Now, I have just for 2 minutes some slides. I hope it works. Sharon? She's a technical expert right here to the right. Okay. Okay. The Islamic State, as Mike indicated, there is a evolution of the name going back actually to 1999, and therefore we shouldn't be surprised about a surprise. We simply didn't follow through what happened on the ground. And again, we were dealing with one of the most vicious groups, I think, in the history. And their leaders and their operatives, they clearly represent a threat, not only in the region, but globally, and we're going to go into it, controlling vast territories, as we know. But as you will see, they act locally, they think globally, and they do have the five-year plan, meaning not only to take over the Middle East and establish the caliphate there, but also Europe, for example, the Balkans and Spain and Africa as well, and we'll come back to it. Obviously, as Mike indicated, the Al-Qaeda, and now I think we mark the 13th anniversary of the 9/11 attack next month, in 2 weeks or so. And obviously, when we talk about the Al-Qaeda, we have to talk about many other affiliates. The point I'm making is that there is no way that we can discuss the ISIS in isolation with some of the other groups that do exist and still represent a very major threat to many societies. In North Africa, we studied that in the Maghreb, in the Sahel, and so on. Basically, every country in that particular region as an Al-Qaeda affiliate, for example, in the Maghreb, going all the way from the Atlantic to the Red Sea, in the Kenya, for example, Somalia, and so on. And obviously, Mike mentioned the attack, the anniversary on the embassies in Kenya and Tanzania. I want to mention also the anniversary, the attack that we had in Kenya of the takeover of the mall, that people became surprised how could that group take over and terrorize an entire city and country. So in other words, we have to be concerned what's happening also in that region. And then, of course, the Hezbollah. There is a New York Times, as you can see, report, which is really not up to date at the time, the attack on the U.S. Marine base in Beirut. And General Gray, of course, has a personal knowledge and involvement in this. And at that time, Reagan insisted that the United States would play a role. But then we saw what happened when the U.S. withdrew from Lebanon. So we have to look at the Hezbollah and potentially what Hezbollah might do in the coming weeks or months. For example, now some groups of the Al-Qaeda took over the Qunetra in the Golan Heights, about 200 yards from the Israeli border. They might open a second front. Then, of course, the Hamas are going all the way back, and we are talking about the brutalization of that particular group. This is the justice that we have seen now in Gaza in terms of killing, executing those who were accused of collaboration with Israel, dragging their bodies in the streets of Gaza. And then, of course, the Boko Haram that emerged as a major threat in Africa, but also with aspirations globally. Now, the common ground, I think that we ought to pay attention to and discuss today, there are two aspects. One, of course, the intentions of the group and the goal to establish a national, regional, global caliphate. And secondly, the capabilities all the way from primitive to smart power, propaganda, recruitment of foreign fighters, for example. And today there was a big article in the Washington Post dealing with the so-called American volunteers and fighters. I don't know if you had a chance to see it, but talking about Americans, but it's not only the Americans. Actually, every particular country in the West is involved, and there is more concern in Europe. The alliances, the networks controlling those territories, the financial support, the capability to obtain funds, for example, from oil, and also the quality of their training, modern weapons, oppressing populations, women, children, minorities, and so on. And finally, we have to pay very close attention to those who commit war crimes and crimes against humanity. In other words, the bottom line is the rule of law, international law, domestic law still relevant to deal with these issues. So again, my professor many years ago, Sam Huntington at Columbia University, was trying to advance the concept of the clash of civilization. In my view, I think we have to be concerned about the clash of cultures, the culture of life and the culture of death. And the ISIS and the other terrorist groups, both theological as well as secular and nationalist, they represent actually the philosophy of death. Hopefully, we can discuss two issues here today. One, the nature and the intensity of the threat of ISIS and some other affiliate groups. And secondly, what can society do about it in order to reduce the risk and bring it under manageable levels? As we understand, as we speak, I think the president and his national security team are meeting in order to decide what options are available to the United States and their friends and allies and like-minded nations to deal with the issue of Syria and Iraq. But we have the short-term concern, but I submit that we have to look at the long-term challenges and opportunities. And with this, I would like to invite Professor Westwood to begin the discussion. Would you kindly come up here?
I need chairs too.
Can you
move like chairs? Politics. Well, thank you, Yonah, for having me. I guess the shorter people in the room get to speak first. That's the rule of deference. We are small, physically small, but verbally aggressive. But it's a pleasure to be back here. I'm by training a lawyer. Was a federal prosecutor for quite a while. Did some terrorism cases, actually. Did the remnants of the Weather Underground and terrorist financing cases. And now teach at Johns Hopkins SAIS, which deserves your financial support since it's a wonderful school facing a tough economy. I am, I think, equally ignorant as most of you about the actual etiology of ISIS. I think one of the great surprises is how little we know about it. I was warned by a Christian Armenian friend of mine who was from Syria that the balance in Syria was so delicate that really, bastard though he is, Assad was one of the few people who probably could keep the country mended together, much as one doesn't like him or his tactics and certainly his vicious ways in killing civilians. But when Syria fell apart, I had very much in mind the warning that was given to me by this Christian Syrian about how difficult it was to manage the debris left by the Sykes-Picot Agreement and how it didn't match the ethnography of tribes or their economic stakes or their ideological affiliations. So I do think that once again, like 9/11, we're just caught quite flat-footed. In 9/11, we had no idea really what was up, and in Iraq, we didn't know who was who, and once again, I think a policy lesson, if you will, is that we are really extraordinarily deficient in our mapping of the ideological currents of radical Islam and militant Islam, and something that is hard to remedy given our general views of not recruiting people without thorough vetting and no family members abroad, but is something that leaves us quite blind and deaf. I also think, if you want a big takeaway, it's an obvious point, but it's the most important, this is not the moment to be drawing down American military capabilities. Ain't nobody else to do it but us. The French are scared, the Brits are relatively modest in their capabilities now, and this is not the time. I think if I was President Obama, I would announce with great drama a reversal in my funding proposals for the Department of Defense, and I would not be shutting down weapons systems, and I would not be drawing down the armed forces. It's just the exact wrong moment, both in signal for the enemy and our actual capability. I don't think, to be honest, that our failure to leave a residual force in Iraq would have had much to do with it, because it was going to be a very small force at best, but it is a signal in a sense of what seemed to be our attitude of washing our hands of the region. One of my great worries for the last 30 years has been what I call malign multilateralism. We all talk about the virtues of acting multilaterally. Well, it's not just the good guys who do it or don't do it, it's the bad guys. So you can have, whether it's the shoot-down of Lockerbie or anything else, you can have actually cooperative relationships between radical groups that just can have, you know, conjoined operational objectives. So the morphing of names is interesting if you're trying to pinpoint how to get them in the solar plexus. But ultimately, the current of violence and radicalism that is sweeping the region is not going to be quelled by tamping down any particular organization. That said, I have to say that now I had a semi-French mother who raised me on memories of Charles Martel and the Battle of Tours, and I have Eastern European friends who remember the Turks at the gate. I like the Turks, but Turks at the gate of Vienna. So indeed, the issue of the extent of Christian Europe, if you will, and a Christian, Jewish, Muslim Europe, and the rest of the Islamic world is one that's been in contest for quite a while. It's not in a sense a new issue. Clearly, the law enforcement model is not sufficient, and on this, I guess I took a few blows during the last several years. I don't believe in torture, but I do believe that you can't meet this purely by military means, nor by law enforcement means. That you're going to have to use actions that do not turn upon proof beyond a reasonable doubt, because you'll never have that. So that capturing people and putting them on trial in the Southern District of New York will not be a sufficient way of addressing this. I once had a nice dinner conversation with he will remain nameless, but a very eminent former prosecutor in New York City. And I asked him what he thought about putting 9/11 people on trial in the Southern District of New York. And he said, do you know what that would mean? The New York District Attorney's Office tries 50,000 cases a year with 4 or 5 witnesses each, and those 250,000 people couldn't get to court. So quite apart from the vicissitudes of proof beyond a reasonable doubt, no hearsay, very restrictive rules on what you can present in court, quite apart from the possible intimidation of juries, in fact, trying this as a criminal matter is not going to be what turns the day. Obviously, the Israeli-Palestinian peace process is, at this point, a footnote. It's not going to drive the region, and its success is going to be completely frustrated by the example of the region. I was on the Harvard campus during the Troubles, which I didn't take part, which I once mentioned to Nathan Pusey, and he said, were you one of the diaper babies? And I said, no. Those were the old children of the Communist Party. But it was true that there was a mood afoot that was very hard to quell, so that even liberals were slightly seduced by the complaints that were put. And here, too, I think it's going to be a generation before this mood of anomie, of kind of a blood culture, of violence for its own sake, violence as sport, will be quelled down. One would like to have economic development in the region to give young men something to do. One would not like to be in bed with repressive military regimes like the current Egyptian regime. But on the other hand, there are very few levers with which we can work in the present time. So I don't have anything happy or useful to say. other than my big takeaway is do not reduce the American military capability. Do not do this, because it doesn't stay home. It flies on airplanes. It comes here. And if we don't help our friends and allies and more friendly enemies in the Middle East to tamp this down, it will be here. It will be here anyway because of the other great problem which every European country faces. Lord knows Midlands England faces it, which is that with relatively free emigration, with the shortage of manpower after World War II and the welcoming of many people from the Middle Eastern region, most of whom were wonderful people, into European countries, whether they became citizens or not so much in Germany. Nonetheless, there are huge populations of young men, often unemployed, in England and France and Germany and elsewhere, who will, this was a saying from the old bad student days of the revolution, always move left. Not good advice, but often taken by young people. And with calls to arm and to jihad, it will be very, very hard for young people to resist this. So I think Europe has an extraordinary problem that it's going to have to meet by, again, other than purely law enforcement methods. It needs to, the Germans, I'll give you one example from my prosecuting days. The Germans were always very, very diffident about law enforcement methods, things that reminded them of the Nazis or the Stasi. They, of course, were skittish about. But wiretaps exist for a good reason. Informants exist for a good reason. Undercover operations exist for a good reason. And in keeping Europe governable, I think a number of liberal societies are going to have to consider methods of more aggressive law enforcement, such as we use here, subject to civil liberties and court supervision, to try to get inside some of the radicalized groups in Liverpool, Paris, elsewhere, and make sure that they are at least monitored, if not shut down. So I wish we weren't having this meeting, and I wish we were only worrying about the economy and the global labor chain. But one doesn't choose one's time or issues. So thank you for having me, Jonah.
My name is Wayne Zaidman. Like Yonah mentioned, I was overseas in the Middle East in the legal attaché program. The legal attaché program is basically the FBI director's representative in foreign countries. So I covered Lebanon, Syria, Jordan, the Palestinian Authority, and Israel during different times. But for about 17 years, I was an agent, special agent in the FBI, covering counterterrorism and counterintelligence Middle East, and then I was spent time in headquarters as a supervisor, a unit chief, and an assistant section chief. So with that background, I would like to say that I agree with Professor Wedgwood that, and it may sound strange coming from somebody from law enforcement, but law enforcement is not the answer to our current predicaments. And I found it very disturbing when I heard President Obama recently say after the abhorrent beheading of James Foley, that he's going to make sure that we identify the perpetrator, bring the perpetrator to justice, and and locate him and bring him to justice. This to me is reminiscent of the old days, the pre-9/11 days of the FBI, where the slogan was, it blows up, we show up. It was completely reactive. A crime occurs, a terrorism event, and then the whole unit, in the case of Osama bin Laden, analysts, supervisors, managers, all working for years, maybe 2 years, 3 years, on developing evidence, presenting prosecutive summary reports to the U.S. attorney, and then after that, bringing it to court, and they may or may not ever find the people. If they do, they'll bring them to the U.S. District Court. And then you have problems of is there adequate evidence for beyond a reasonable doubt? And then you have to worry about the fact that besides that, there's the problem of sources and methods. So let's say the FBI is working with the CIA, military intelligence, NSA, other agencies. A lot of the information is provided for intelligence purposes only. They don't want to end up testifying in court. They don't want to destroy sources on the ground. So they don't want to give you evidence. And on the flip side, the attorneys, U.S. attorneys and the grand juries want to maintain the secrecy of their evidence before the grand juries and don't want to share it. So it provided one of the biggest problems of information sharing. So I'm hoping that we don't go back to that, because after 9/11, there was a huge culture change within the FBI, and we began treating them as intelligence investigations. So no longer is the primary desire to identify somebody, find them, and convict them in a court of law here. It was strictly to disrupt and to defeat terrorism before it happens, to be proactive, to prevent terrorist actions from occurring in the United States. Some of the examples that were mentioned were Kenya, Tanzania, the East African bombings, the USS Cole, Cobra Towers. These were all treated as criminal investigations. And it was a dismal failure. So it should remain a war on terrorism. And I say a war on terrorism because it's not a law enforcement thing. And we have to identify our enemies and remember who our friends are. We have to return to the terms terrorism and the terms Islamic extremism. For a while, that was after the Obama came into office, that was stricken from the vocabulary of the FBI and other U.S. government agencies. It's no more terrorism, it's man-made disasters, and it's no more Islamic extremism, because that's not politically correct. We have to identify what the enemy is. The enemy is not Islam, it's not all Muslims, that's understood. But the enemy is Islamic extremism, and while not all terrorists are Muslims, that's certainly the case. In recent years, we've seen that most of the terrorist incidents have been conducted by Islamic extremists. So we have to understand that. Guantanamo Bay, Gitmo. That was something that when Obama took office, he made a pledge he was immediately going to close down Gitmo. Well, that also was a policy that was doomed to dismal failure, because they are not criminals, they're enemy combatants. It would be a grave mistake to bring the detainees to the U.S. and put them on civilian trial. That was seen when they made a few attempts to do it. If the evidence is not strong enough, or due to sources and methods, and the person gets acquitted, which could easily happen, then they're acquitted, they're free. So now we have terrorist threats in wherever they're tried, in New York, in Chicago, or in Los Angeles, wherever. One of the reasons for Gitmo is that their home countries don't want them back. These were terrorists that started out maybe in the war in Afghanistan against the Soviets, and they went through the Bosnian-Serbian war and all the various Al-Qaeda manifestations. So their home countries don't want them back. And that's a problem that we have with ISIS and all these other groups, is that a lot of them have British passports, they have U.S. passports, they have Canadian passports. So do we want them back? If they all came back here after fighting in Syria or Iraq or Lebanon or wherever they're fighting, we got a big problem. I mean, now we have an FBI with reduced resources and a military with reduced resources, and we got to keep track of, lots of people in addition to the ones we're already keeping track of. So it's a big problem. As I mentioned, other intelligence agencies are reluctant to cooperate if they're not assured that the evidence is going to be used in the way they want it to be used. And that's no less relevant for foreign cooperation. As a legal attaché, as a legate overseas, I met with intelligence agencies, with security agencies, with police agencies from the host countries. And in many cases, they cooperate with us because it's reciprocal. We help them, they help us. But they also say, in most cases, that it's not for law enforcement purposes, it's for intelligence purposes only. So they have a right to limit, if they're giving us information, they can limit how it's being used. So again, it doesn't lend itself well to law enforcement purposes. Rendition. Another activity that's been widely condemned by some circles within the administration. Rendition is used to transfer captured terrorist subjects from one country to another for detention, arrest, and interrogation. They will be afforded the legal protection in place in the country detaining and interrogating them. In other words, they're not subject to U.S. laws. If they're in Egypt, they're subject to Egyptian laws. If they're in Jordan, they're subject to Jordanian laws, et cetera. So the information that they obtain, those host countries, can then provide that information to U.S. intelligence and or law enforcement personnel. And think of it this way. If we insist on not letting those host countries deal with it in their way and bring them to the United States, now they're immediately subject to U.S. law, which means you give them Miranda warnings, you give them an attorney, you ensure that they're going to keep their mouth shut immediately. You're not going to get any intelligence information. You're not going to potentially save lives as a result of getting information that could possibly save American lives and other lives. So basically, we let them do the interviews. We don't do it. And we can provide them with questions. We can provide them with things we're looking for, and hopefully they will then provide it to us. So it would be a mistake to do away with renditions. Former CIA Director Michael Hayden stated, renditions have been conducted lawfully, responsibly, with a clear and simple purpose, to get terrorists off the streets and gain intelligence on those still at large. He said that in 2007. Okay, now what about the targets? We're talking about ISIS now, but we have to understand that Islamic extremists are basically of one mind. So whether it's ISIS, ISIL, or Hezbollah, or Hamas, or Islamic Jihad, or Boko Haram, or al-Nusra, or al-Qaeda, whichever one you're dealing with, they all view the world to be within the abode of the Dar al-Islam, the abode of Islam, or Dar al-Harb, the abode of war. And by that, they mean that there has to be a continuous jihad, interrupted only by occasional hudnas, temporary truces, until the world is made up of countries that are either ruled by Islamic law, or the people inside convert to Islam, or at least they're required to submit to Islamic law. An example, besides ISIS, Hamas holds that all of Palestine is an Islamic waqf, and no part of it can be negotiated or compromised away by any leader. To do so would be an act of heresy, and a leader would be labeled as an infidel, or worse yet, a mushrik in Arabic, which means a polytheist or a pagan. It's no surprise that they have no desire to negotiate with Israel. It also shows how Christians and Jews, for example, have been relabeled. They were traditionally called people of the book, and by being people of the book, they were allowed certain protections while they're living within Islamic countries. But if the Islamic extremists rename them as mushrikeen, pagans, no longer Christians or Jews, then all bets are off, and they can be subject to anything they want them to be subject to, including beheading. Also, Islamic extremists have no desire to limit casualties. It used to be in the old terrorist days when they were left-wing groups, it was they wanted to play to the media, and they wanted to try to reduce civilian casualties in order to gain support and sympathy. But Islamic extremists, their audience is not the international community. Their audience is God, and they pretend to know what God wants of them. So therefore, terrorism becomes a sacred act. There was always a reluctance to shut down Islamic front groups, like they were called Islamic charities, even though the FBI and other groups knew that they were furnishing material support to terrorist groups. It was believed that they would not pass this, quote, smell test. In other words, if you see in the New York Times or Washington Post on the weekend that we shut down charities and poor little children and women and orphans and widows are not getting their money. So no action was taken. Even though the monies were not used to buy bread and cheese, they were used for bullets, bombs, and missiles. One notable exception was the Holy Land Foundation, where there was a prosecution. But there are many, many other front groups in the United States. One of the more visible ones is CARE, that you see on the news frequently. Unfortunately, there are a lot of elements within government that use groups like CARE as consultants or as partners against terrorism. It's really misguided. It'll never succeed. And we have to remember who our friends are and who our enemies are. One of the policy change things that the Obama administration did, which puzzles me and I'll never understand it, is that they invited the Ikhwan Muslimin, the Muslim Brotherhood, into Egypt, into Tunisia. They decided that this was going to be a partner for peace, that somehow that was going to be successful. And another example is when Gaddafi was overthrown after he had disarmed and dismantled his nuclear program. Now, does this make any sense to anybody? I ask you. After Bush went into Iraq, Gaddafi said, I changed my mind, I want to ally with the West, and here's the keys to the nuclear sites. I'm totally dismantling it. So then we go in and we take over the regime and kill them. Now we're talking about Iran now, and we're saying to Iran, oh, dismantle your nuclear weapons. What kind of a lesson does that give to Iran? If I was Iran, I probably would say, up yours, as far as getting me to do it. But what I see is, in the confirmation hearings of Secretary of Defense Hagel, he made what the news media said was a slip up. He said the policy is containment, and then he was brought a note by one of the aides saying, oh no, it's not the right, it's not containment. We're going to prevent Iran from getting nuclear weapons like we promised. Well, now it becomes obvious that he was really telling the truth. He just wasn't supposed to at that time, because that apparently is the policy. Instead of, under these current negotiations, instead of saying, dismantle, which was always our request, that you have to dismantle your program, they're saying you can continue to enrich. And we're going to give you another 6 months, and then we're going to give you another 6 months. So the end result is that our friends, like Egypt, Jordan, Israel, tend to become our adversaries, and we beat up on them. And groups like Islamic extremist groups and groups like the Muslim Brotherhood, the Ikhwan, we embrace with both arms. And the Ikhwan doesn't believe in contemporary nation states. They believe artificial boundaries prevent the golden ideal of the Islamic Caliphate. Any lands that were at any time controlled by Muslims, including Lebanon, Israel, Spain, which was Andalusia, parts of Europe, must be regained by jihad. Populations must convert to Islam, or at the very least, submit to Muslim rule. So here we have the Muslim Brotherhood saying basically what ISIS is saying, or ISIL. So I think we have to examine our policies and get back on the right footing and understand that, number one, we must continue to treat terrorism as an intelligence investigation. Two, we must identify the enemy and eliminate them as a threat to the U.S. and or our U.S. allies. We must know our real allies and make use of them in a coalition, such as Egypt, Jordan, Israel, parts of Saudi Arabia. I say that because they have their factions which support us and their factions which don't support us. Finally, we must target front groups and follow the money trails and material support of terrorism. Thank you.
We got the chairs are tight here.
Afternoon. As Yonah said, I'm a rather standard issue American professional diplomat, or rather retired one. And therefore, I will address this question from my professional perspective, sometimes called professional deformation, as does everybody else who deals with the subject. Therefore, I will try to look at it from the perspective of international politics, international trends, historic trends, and the role of diplomacy. Not a terribly popular perspective these days, but as we've learned in the last 10, 12 years, we ignore these questions at our cost. Now, the present international system was begun by the Peace of Westphalia, which so ingrained in our worldview that we tend not to think about it very much, although references to the treaties of Westphalia and the nation-state system are usually de rigueur for diplomats, academics, and upscale op-ed writers. But the system, which began in the 17th century, was so accepted that it became the basic anti-colonial argument of the 20th century. The disappearing colonial regimes, particularly in the Middle East, largely European, were quite consciously replaced by replica nation states, although of varying colors: nationalist, leftist, authoritarian, collectivist, theocratic, and once in a while even democratic. The growth in the membership of the United Nations from the original 50 to the over 190 today is a record of that growth of change in the international political structure. Everybody wants to be a nation. Now, this essentially consensual international system doesn't operate with anything close to perfection. It has been challenged several times in the past. Napoleon in his revolutionary mode, and most recently by the Soviet Union, which attempted to replace the nation-state system with a governance system founded upon a version of a theory of economic class. Today, however, while it is still the universal system in the world, it is being challenged on several fronts. First of all, at least in some regions, particularly the Middle East, by sheer incompetence and by social political pressures. This is particularly marked in the Middle East, the Arab Middle East, which is apparently in a state of disintegration as ancient conflicts reoccur. Arab-Persian, Turk-Persian, Turk-Arab, Sunni-Shia, secular-religious, modern-traditional, democratic-authoritarian, national-tribal, rich-poor. As a gazetted outsider, because I'm not a Middle East expert by any means, I'm struck by the obvious observation that the three most obviously competent nation states in the region, Iran, Turkey, and Israel, are not Arabs. But the most dramatic challenge to the Westphalian system is the resurgence of another ancient experiment in governance, the Islamic Caliphate. The original Islamic Caliphate preceded the Westphalian system by several centuries. Although in some respects it resembled its imperial peers, the Sassanid Persian Empire and the Byzantine Empire, it was fundamentally different as it claimed global universality on the basis of revealed religion. Essentially, the Islamic Caliphate denied legitimacy of governance to every other system of governance. Pursuing that vision, excuse me again, the Islamic Caliphate spread over much of all of what we now call the Middle East and much of what we now call Europe until it was rolled back from the Iberian Peninsula and then finally, as has been noted, by Vienna in 1683. But by the time of the last siege of Vienna, the Caliphate had lost a good deal of its purely Islamic religious character. Under the Mongols, who were not Muslims when they arrived on the scene, the Caliphate had morphed into a more traditional empire, a more political, military, power-organized empire. In any case, the Ottoman Empire and its Caliphate identity died, disappeared in 1922, to be replaced, surprise, by a consciously national nation-state in its heartland, and French and English created colonial and protectorate regimes elsewhere in the region. As the 20th century moved on, the European regimes, these European colonial protectorate regimes, were replaced by a collection of ostensibly Westphalian nation states. However, to many in the area, this was an alien framework, which to this day still competes with religious and tribal identities. But at the same time this was happening, the decolonization was happening, the counter-revolution, if we may call it that, of Islamic governance was being reborn. Intrinsic in the teachings of the Salafists or jihadists, or whatever you want to call them, was a call for the return of Islamic governance and the Islamic Caliphate. While this claim was recognized by many, this aspect of the challenge was submerged in the more immediate threats of violence on a local level. Substate violence exercised by various groups, some of them jihadists, arising from various local backgrounds, Sunni, Shia, Turkish, Syrian, Iraqi, Lebanese, Palestinian, and so on. But the caliphate problem is obviously more fundamental than local fights for power. ISIS is clear about its long-term expansionist and exclusionary caliphate project. That ambition has become clear to the governments of the area as well as to concerned outliers like the United States, and we are an outlier. Obviously, something is missing or wrong in the existing and social political orders in the region, wrong so that the revolutionary, or maybe it's reactionary, Islamic governance model as practiced by ISIS is somehow able to attract growing numbers of adherents. The trite phrase root causes comes to the tongue easily, but is nevertheless pertinent. National leaders in the area must somehow identify and deal with these root causes as matters of urgent necessity. Certainly among them is Sunni discontent and the appeal of the ISIS promise to return them to a dominant position in the area. In the history of Islam in the Middle East, the caliphate marked a period of Sunni dominance and is being touted by ISIS as the proper form of government for all real Muslims, and implicitly, therefore, a return to Sunni dominance. However, this challenge also has a very immediate tactical aspect that grabs the attention of the media and all of us. The violence on the street is approaching anarchy and chaos, attracting the four horsemen of the apocalypse. It must be, that part of it must be dealt with today somehow in some way. So defeating ISIS requires Muslim nations, to see ISIS as the threat it really is to them. This has been a problem up to now, as most, including like Iraq, have been mired in religious and national competitions and divisions of their own nature and their own optic. Many have had their own relations with extremists of one sort or another. ISIS has received financing from a number of people, from donors in Kuwait and Qatar. Saudi Arabia has furnished weapons, not worried about where they're going. Turkey allowed ISIS fighters and weapons to flow across porous borders. I recently received across my email chain an email which rather sarcastically but accurately described this situation. The title line on the email was, "Are you confused by what is going on in the Middle East?" And the text says, quote, "Let me explain. We support the Iraqi government in the fight against ISIS. We don't like ISIS, but ISIS is supported by Saudi Arabia, who we do like. We don't like Assad in Syria. We support this fight against him, but ISIS is also fighting against him. We don't like Iran, but Iran supports the Iraqi government in its fight against ISIS. So some of our friends support our enemies. Some enemies are now our friends. And some of our enemies are fighting against our other enemies who we want to lose. But we don't want our enemies who are fighting our enemies to win. If the people we want to defeat are defeated, they could be replaced by people we like even less. It's quite simple, really. Do you understand now?" All of that has to stop, and there are signs of that happening in recent days, as the challenge is now being recognized around the circuit of chanceries. The media is full of recently of verbal and practical adjustments underway, from Tehran to Ankara to Jeddah and beyond. The Sunni, Shia, Persian, Arab, and other spats are being reevaluated, and alliances are being reconsidered. The Saudis made a significant financial contribution to UN anti-terrorism programs. There have been recent public statements by Iranian and Saudi leaders together. Turkish policy towards the Kurds has been evolving. And there's a lot of highly public agonizing going on in Washington, as you may have noticed. Anybody notice the Washington Post in the last week or so? So the threat, the challenge of ISIS must be met at several levels immediately as well as over time. Defeating or even substantially frustrating ISIS will require a broad coalition of nations and addressing not only military threat, but political and religious issues. This will require some sort of grand strategy. First step in creating this grand strategy is identifying its authors and its participants. A coalition of the willing is required, actually a coalition of the threatened, but that phrase lacks certain elan, certain enthusiasm, and it must be based on the Muslim countries of the region. So Such a grand strategy must be multilateral and as much political as military, in fact, even more so. If ever military activity is supposed to be the extension of politics and not indulged in for its own sake, this is the situation and this is the time. We must not let tactics eclipse strategy. A long-term strategy marshaling allies and addressing the region's political dysfunction is required, and the operative word is long-term. Now, the need to organize such a grand alliance is currently a matter of high priority in presidential palaces and chancellors all around the world. This task is very difficult, if only because it requires a serious reconsideration of many previous and existing policies and practices, including for the United States. Eventually, we must consider questions not only of what, how much, and how soon, but with whom. We can only imagine the amount of scrabbling that must be going on in offices as staffs are being driven crazy by principals screaming for information and answers. We may be in a moment of historic change or shift of relationships and pressures. Meanwhile, as this is going on, the response to the immediate challenge is being determined by the key policy question that lies just below the surface of everything we're talking about and everyone concerned. When does the enemy of my enemy become my ally? And at what cost? Thank you.
Thank you. Really brilliant from Edward Marks, I think. So I'm Dan Raviv, and I'm, the journalist and the historian on the panel who hasn't been a diplomat or a soldier, but has watched all of this unfold. And a lot of people wonder if it's just sort of history repeats itself and, you know, the same things keep happening and we don't learn lessons. I don't really feel that way. I mean, part of what's so fascinating about news and history is that it is new. There is something new. And the ISIS movement really deserves a major concern. Sure, it grew out of things, as the slide earlier said, it grew out of things, especially in Iraq, that we didn't pay enough attention to, that we sort of knew was not resolved, that Sunni Muslims would be angry, that they would find alliances, ways to form even a new organization that shows many aspects of being an army. So that is ISIS. But what's the biggest concern? The biggest concern, if you're a democratic nation, is protecting your own people. And so we come back to one of the biggest issues always here at the Potomac Institute, and that is terrorism and what might happen in our own country, in the United States, and in our allied nations. And there really is a danger. I don't want to repeat the obvious. It's been in the news, of course, that ISIS has Western citizens with Western passports. They might come back to England, France, Italy, and, well, even the United States. They could commit terrorism here. It's a real danger, and if job number one for a Western democratic government is to keep its citizens safe, then this merits major public attention. When it comes to Americans who apparently have joined Islamic radical movements in Syria and maybe in Iraq, after all, to ISIS, the border doesn't exist, so far we've had two who've gotten a lot of media attention. This week there was the death of a man improbably named Douglas MacArthur, all right, actually Douglas MacArthur McCain, from Minneapolis, spent time in San Diego. In Minneapolis, well, apparently he became a convert to Islam and thought it was really cool to hang out with Somalis, many of whom had become radicalized, and he thought it would make sense to go to Syria and join the battle. We've heard about that kind of thing happening. Well, McCain was confirmed killed in some battle in Syria this past weekend. And the State Department had to answer questions about it. The U.S. government confirms and try to offer consular services to the extent possible. And of course, we're fascinated by what, you know, turned this guy. But he's not unique. There have been others. Another who got some publicity a few months ago blew himself up in Syria. So he was a young man from Florida. He actually was born as an American Muslim, said to be a Palestinian American. His last name was Abu Salha. And perhaps you've seen his angry video, because in fact, at least one of the Islamic Front organizations in Syria decided to make a big hero of him, a big example of him. He's a martyr to them, after all. And so we have his angry speech, you know, lashing out. So he's going to attack this country and that country, and we are, and after we take care of the Ashams, meaning the Levant area, we'll turn to Israel, and we'll fight for Palestine, and we're after you next, Israel, and all that. Grandiose ideas. And then he's assigned to drive a truck and push a button and blow himself up, apparently killing some Syrian soldiers. All right, listen, I'm not going to belittle or magnify these acts, but I will point out that at least those two examples and two others that, in fact, U.S. government sources say they've heard of now, one in Syria and one in Iraq, that's a total of four at least, they died over there. Now, does that tell me, can I relax? Oh, they don't have a plan, after all, to use their foreign passports and their Western faces to re-inject them into Western society and one day blow themselves up at a shopping mall? Because, again, we've discussed that here at the Potomac Institute. It doesn't have to be 9/11. It doesn't have to be some brilliant, complicated attack. It doesn't have to be four buses and tube trains in London. It could just be something relatively small on a world scale. But you know, in the United States especially, that would shake things up incredibly. So the main job of a Western democratic government, keep its own people safe, also for the sake of keeping the society safe, so the stock market doesn't crash 800 points when there's some act of terrorism in the United States. So the economy is important. So lives are important. So stopping bloodshed's important. But how do you do that? Just war? Sending troops to where we've had troops before? No, clearly not just that. You got to have a mix. As a matter of fact, if ISIS is new, and to me it is new, ignoring borders and being multinational and having these high ambitions and having Westerners as volunteers, and I'm sure some of them would be willing to kill themselves. If they are new, then we need a new game, and a complex one, and one that doesn't just involve the military. And if it involves the military, then please, not 80,000 troops, but something more clever, and special operators and people behind the lines and folks whose missions are not acknowledged, to the extent that it involves the military. Of course, it's got to involve our intelligence agencies. And of course, we've learned, dare I use the phrase, thanks to Edward Snowden, is it okay to say that? We've learned some of the capabilities of, say, the electronic intelligence and SIGINT parts of United States intelligence. And they are formidable. And we can listen and monitor and watch, unless your enemy, of course, is totally refusing to use electronic media and not using the internet and not using mobile phones. Well, that doesn't seem to be true. At the very least, after all, this enemy, this growing enemy, ISIS, loves issuing propaganda videos and messages and beheadings. There is something to trace there. There is something for intelligence agencies to work on in order to locate people, to identify people. It's not an impossible task, but this is not an episode of Homeland on TV. It's not going to be solved in 1 hour or even 13 episodes. It requires patient work, but there's a lot to do. A lot to actually come to grips with, and things that we can use and leverage. So we need to monitor ISIS. It can be challenging. To the extent we can, we need to penetrate ISIS. Now use your own imagination here. If they welcome Western volunteers, it's not going to be incredibly, impossibly difficult to penetrate ISIS, is it? Like I say, use your imagination. People who are good at intelligence and counterterrorism do. Again, it can require mammoth amounts of patience. And if you do have an agent inside, either because somehow you've turned somebody or you've managed to send someone, inject someone into it as a mole, that doesn't mean you use them right away. Often it's a long-term activity. All of this could be going on. How do you make ISIS break up or surrender? Well, it turns out, and maybe especially in that part of the world, you want to humiliate them. You want them to look like losers. You want things to go wrong. You want the local communities, the Sunni Muslims of various nations, to reject them, which would be an important part of the solution if that can happen. right? Edward Marks mentioned that. That would be an important thing. The Sunni nations actually reject them. The Sunni nations show some backbone. So part of the political solution is something the Obama administration mentions consistently, which is a better government in Iraq. All right, it is meaningful. If Sunni Muslims, they are, after all, the minority in Iraq, felt left out of things and felt embittered, they were either going to join the Islamic State or at least support the Islamic State or look the other way or offer hiding places or money or food or travel routes. It really makes a difference if the local population turns against them. Al-Qaeda in Iraq started to dry up and diminished when the Sunnis in that part of Iraq turned against them. There wasn't anything to be gained by supporting AQI, which has morphed into this wider movement in Syria and Iraq. But if you can get Sunnis to turn against them, it makes a difference. So part of the political solution, better government in Iraq, sure. How about in Syria? Well, sure, that would be nice. Syria, of course, has had a civil war for 3.5 years. It's like a big black hole. We know that terrorists will fill that kind of vacuum. So there's so many costs to the Syrian civil war, not the least of which almost 200,000 people who've died. Just think about that for a moment. And of course, many of them have died awful deaths that would make unbelievable stories in the world media if we could get there and we could show them and we could show suffering children and families, etc. Of course, we've done some of that. We've done some of the refugee stories from Turkey and Jordan and the other neighboring countries. It hasn't changed much. You know, the background has changed. Who are the rebels in Syria? Are there still groups that we could support? Are there moderate rebels? Well, I'll share with you some of the knowledge that Israel has acquired, because that's my specialty. And my blog, by the way, is israelspy.com. And so with my co-author, Yossi Melman, we write about Israel. Now, a lot of people think Israel's so good at intel, and Israel's there, kind of at the point of the spear on the battlefront. So they must understand ISIS. They must have understood Al-Qaeda. Some people even make up a story that they must have known about Al-Qaeda and its ambitions even before 9/11. And maybe the Israelis should have warned us about the World Trade Center. No, no, you got to understand what goes on. Israel's a country of 8 million people. Think about where it is in the Eastern Med. It feels surrounded by enemies. That's, you know, there's certainly their self-image. And they've got their own problems. And so, yes, Israel picks up information. They supply information to Western intelligence agencies. They have regular intel exchanges with the CIA and other American agencies. True, but it's not Israel's first priority to understand Al-Qaeda if it's sort of far away, or some other loud-mouthed group that calls itself Islamic and lists among its demands that Israel be replaced by Palestine. Israel says, yeah, well, we're kind of busy. Now, they do gather files, I'll give you that. But even Israel's been surprised with what's happened in Syria. You see, at the beginning, when the civil war began in early 2011, from an Israeli point of view, it was, oh, this is pretty good. President Bashar al-Assad will be weakened. He's supported by Iran. He's closely linked with the Hezbollah in Lebanon. So if Bashar al-Assad is having problems, good. Do we want him overthrown? We're not so sure, is what people in Israeli intelligence said. We're not so sure. Because we have him well monitored. We know all his phone numbers. We know everything going on in the Assad regime. Maybe it's better to have, well, the devil you know. Well, as the years went by, Israel was fascinated by what was happening with rebel groups, and certainly that gave other opportunities for Israeli intelligence to get to know them, to meet them in Europe, to meet them in Turkey. That's the way it works. You know, to get together, to have information, to have some exchanges. Our common enemy is Assad. As I said, the Israelis didn't think they wanted him overthrown, but they did want him crippled, hobbled, distracted, no question. Somehow along the way, last year, when Assad went one step too far and killed a few thousand civilians with illegal chemical weapons, the Israelis were concerned. A line's been crossed. Someone of our neighbors, said Israel, has now used these weapons. This is terrible. We'll have to watch that. And then it all became kind of lucky from an Israeli point of view. Obama issued his big red line challenge. Instead, Russia stepped forward, brokered a deal in which Syria has given up its chemical weapons. Yes, I know they still can use chlorine gas and other things that are apparently not classified officially as weapons, weaponized warheads, all that. I got it. The Assad regime is terrible and brutal and still committing these crimes. But think from an Israeli strategic point of view, somehow this Syrian civil war has led to Syria not having chemical weapons anymore. Yippee. But it also makes the Assad regime actually more tolerable, you know, from an Israeli point of view. And as for the alternative, the rebels, well, there's a phrase going around with Israeli intelligence analysts now, the radicals are at the fence. Well, the fence specifically means the Golan Heights armistice line, where the war stopped during the Yom Kippur War in 1973. And so Israel holds most of the Golan Heights. There's this town called Kunetra, you know, that's pretty much a ghost town. Well, rebels on the Syrian side have taken Kunetra and the area nearby. And the Israelis are making sure to understand who they are, the Nusra Front, someone even more Islamic, someone who might be the Free Syrian Army, the group that the United States, at least Senator John McCain, would like to help. The Israelis watch this because now they are at the fence. Well, you know what the Israeli response actually has been in secret, hardly talked about? Try to make contact with just about everybody. Try to be as friendly as we can. Have meetings in refugee camps. And you heard about that hospital in northern Israel, which is humanitarian and wonderful and a good part of Israeli publicity, that they are treating some wounded people from the Syrian civil war in northern Israel. Boy, is that an intelligence bonanza opportunity to interview people, to send people back in, to have meetings, and to treat only your favorite people. To treat some of the people, the family members of maybe someone from one of those major organizations. That's how you make friends in that part of the world. The Israelis know that. So the Israelis, however, don't have the answer. They can't unlock this mystery that we've been talking about, how to protect the United States or Times Square or Trafalgar Square or the Eiffel Tower. No, they can't do that. The Israelis are mostly concerned about their own neck of the woods. But look at this mix here. They're monitoring. They're going to try to penetrate. They're making friends where possible. They're playing off one side against the other. They're sharpening their ability to listen, to speak the perfect Arabic they need to, etc. It's something clearly the United States and its bigger Western allies concerned about job number one, protecting our people at home. It's something that the U.S. and its big allies have to do on a similar and probably even larger scale.
Don, Professor Wallace, you want to say something now or later?
I think I will, just to get this behind me. I think of myself as part of the audience, and I wonder whether you've had the same experience that I've had, which I always have in these programs of Yonah. There's so much, you learn so much, you wonder, can you be sure of yourself, or you're more confused than you should be? I will say one thing. I think Congressman Moran and his colleagues have their job cut out for them. Three points, just very minor ones. One, I think we should remain confident of ourselves. You know, I think Americans are too hard on themselves. We think we're incompetent, inept. I'm a Republican who happens to admire President Obama. I don't think we're as inept as we think we are, and I think it would be awfully important for us to keep our morale rather high, to be intelligent about ourselves. Secondly, I think, of course, we've got to be intelligent about the threat. And I think one thing that comes through fairly clearly, in spite of a very learned, diverse panel, we don't really know that much about ISIS and ISIL. And it isn't that, although it seems like a storm which has blown up in the last few months, as Yonah has pointed out, there are roots. But terrorism, which is one of Yonah's great specialties, may be different from the ambition to have a caliphate, which was pointed out by one of our speakers, that there may be terrorist threats to us here. But this is broader than just miscellaneous terrorists. And we know very little about the geographic scope of ISIS. We're learning more and more from the papers every day about disaffected Sunni Baathists have joined them. I think we've got to learn a great deal more about them. And again, this goes back to the first point. How scared should we be of them? How concerned should we be? And I don't think we really know. I mean, I wouldn't be complacent, don't misunderstand me. And third, of course, is the issue which Ruth and the others touched on. What should be our response? I'm a law professor like Ruth. I use like very broadly, by the way. Certainly law enforcement in and of itself is not the answer. I wouldn't dismiss it at all. If you're public international lawyers, Ruth and I are, there's a real issue. Where does our response fit into the UN system, the right to defend yourself, both in Iraq and Syria? And they're different. In the case of Iraq, we've been asked in by the government to put them down, I suppose. and hopefully that government will be better as the weeks go on. In Syria, it's much trickier. You know, my enemy's enemy may be my friend, but I'm not sure we'd ever admit that Assad is our friend. Although the Israelis quite realistically have sensed that, you know, one should be fairly slow in just wanting to be rid of him. So I think, going back to my first point, I think we should have high morale, have confidence in ourselves, and we've got to beat them, and I think we will. And I think a program like this, and we'll learn more in a few minutes, at least I think gives us a sense of how large and amorphous and complicated this is, as so many other things are today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Don and the panelists. We have time to open a discussion, and I would appreciate if you kindly raise your hand, state your name, ask a question, and then we'll try to develop a discussion. Okay, raise your hands. Okay, Pat Murphy first.
Pat Murphy, I've been doing some research with Alexander on editing a book on NATO. Okay, thank you. Pat Murphy, and I've done some work for Ambassador Alexander recently on a book on NATO, doing some editing. Excuse me. Now, of course, I forgot what I was going to say. It seems to me that one of the main things is that the president has to have an idea of what he really wants to accomplish by this. Excuse me.
Loosen his tie.
I'm a physician.
But one of the points I think really should be stressed is that the president should at some point in the near future tell the American public what it is he wants to do regarding ISIS, not least so that he is clear in his own mind what it is he is trying to accomplish. We should set a goal or a mission, and we should set a strategy after the mission, not after we set the mission, not before. I can remember, I'm old enough to remember, Johnson, just about 50 years ago, when it was clear we were going to stay in Vietnam, I kept on thinking he should go on TV and tell the American public what it is he wants to accomplish in Vietnam, not least so that he will know himself what he's trying to accomplish. And he never did it, and I'm not sure to this day what our real goals were in Vietnam, whether to liberate, to keep the South free, maybe to liberate the North, or whatever. The same applies with regard to ISIS, especially when the president himself has said this is a long, long, long-term project. And some of you pointed out the enemy is my enemy is my friend. I wrote a little piece a couple days ago in which I pointed out there are two triangles going on in Syria. One is between us, Assad, and the enemies of Assad, and the other one is between the enemies of Assad themselves and us. If we drop a bomb on a group of people who are opposed to Assad, are we hitting the Free Syrian Army? Are we hitting ISIS? Or are we hitting some guys who just switched from, because it's happening, from Free Syrian Army to ISIS? You know, there are so many, as a couple of you point out, so many complexities, and so many, the friend of my friend is becoming my enemy, my own friend. You know, these are a few things that just should be thought about, and that's what we're going to try to do this afternoon.
Thank you very much, Fred. Okay, in the back, Mr. Don, can you get the mic over there, please?
Thank you. I'm Charles Dahan. I'm an international advisor. I'm the world vice president of Moroccan Jews. First of all, thank you for every member of the panel. Very, very interesting. The one thing that that was not really spoken more strongly, ISIS, actually a member of the Belge community, has been demonstrating with ISIS flag. And it's been going on for a few years now, and it has not been mentioned. Of course, we all know that the European France, Belgium, Germany, England is a center of recruitment for the ISIS. And it's really what's happening in Belgium is really under the radar, but it's been really very big.
You want to respond, everyone?
Good facts.
I'll make a, Yonah, if I could make a comment?
Yeah, sure. Absolutely.
To answer, I'm just tagging on to your comment to comment to some a few other issues that were mentioned by the panel a bit earlier, that we don't know an awful lot about ISIS's ideology or about ISIS, just like we didn't know an awful lot about Al-Qaeda before 9/11. If you excuse my language, that's crap. Okay, we knew a great deal about Osama bin Laden and Al-Qaeda before 9/11. Yonah and I wrote a book about him a year before 9/11 in which we identified all the leadership, their ideology, and their goals. All you had to do was read what Osama bin Laden had been writing and saying, that he was going to come attack the United States. The same is absolutely true with ISIS. We know their ideology. Just read what they've written. Listen to what they've been saying. They say the streets of America will run with blood. We know what their ideology is. This is not an unknown threat. This is a well-understood threat. So I want to dispel the concept